Chapter 19 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Gail Timmerman Vaughn. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 19. No Englishwoman would have thought of the details which made the feast of the full moon so wonderful in Paul's eyes. It savoured rather of other centuries and the days of imperial Rome, and indeed, had his lady been one of Britain's daughters, he too might have found it a little bizarre. As it was all in the note, the exotic note of Venice and her spells. The lady had gone to her room when he woke on the loggia, and he had only time to dress before the appointed moment when he was to meet her in the little salon. She was seated on the old Venetian chair she had bought in Lucerne when Paul entered, the most radiant vision he had yet seen. Her garment was pale green gauze. It seemed to cling in misty folds round her exquisite shape. It was clasped with pearls. The most magnificent ones hung in a row round her throat and fell from her ears. A diadem confined her glorious hair, which descended in the 2 long strands twisted with chains of emeralds and diamonds. Her whole personality seemed breathing magnificence and panther-like grace, and her eyes glowed with passion and mystery and force. Paul knelt like a courtier and kissed her hand. Then he led her to their feast. Dmitri raised the curtain of the loggia door as they approached, and what a sight met Paul's view! The whole place had been converted into a bower of roses. The walls were entirely covered with them. A great couch of deepest red ones was at one side, fixed in such masses as to be quite resisting and firm. From the roof chains of roses hung, concealing small lights, while from above the screen of lilac bushes in full bloom, the moon in all her glory mingled with the rose-shaded lamps and cast a glamour and unreality over the whole. The dinner was laid on a table in the centre, and the table was covered with tuberoses and stephanotis, surrounding the cupid fountain of perfume. The scent of all these flowers, and the warm summer night. No wonder Paul's senses quivered with exultation. No wonder his head swam. They had scarcely been seated when from the great salon, whose open doors were hidden by falling trellises of roses, there came the exquisite sounds of violins and a boy's plaintive voice. A concert of all sweet airs played softly to further excite the sense. Paul had not thought that such musicians could be obtained in Venice, and guessed, and rightly, that, like the cook and the artist who had designed it, they hailed from Paris to beautify this night. Throughout the repast, his lady bewildered him with her wild fascination. Never before had she seemed to collect all her moods into one settled whole, cemented together by passionate love. It truly was a night of the gods, and the exaltation of Paul's spirit had reached its zenith. "My Paul," she said, when at last only the rare fruits and the golden wine remained, and they were quite alone, even the musicians had retired, and their airs floated up from a gondola below. "My Paul, I want you never to forget this night. Never to think of me, but as gloriously happy, clasped in your arms amid the roses, and see, we must drink once more together of our wedding wine, and complete our soul's delight." An eloquence seemed to come to Paul and loosen his tongue, so that he whispered back paeans of worship in language as fine as her own. And the moon flooded the loggia with her light, and the roses gave forth their scent. It was the supreme effort of art and nature to cover them with this glorious joy. "My darling one," the lady whispered in his ear, as she lay in his arms on the couch of roses, crushed deep and half buried in their velvet leaves. "This is our soul's wedding. In life and in death, they can never part more." Dawn was creeping through the orchid blinds of their sleeping chamber, when this strange queen disengaged herself from her lover's embrace, and bent over him, kissing his young curved lips. He stirred not. The languor of utter prostration was upon him, and held him in its grasp. In the uncertain light, his sleep looked pale as death. The lady gazed at him, an anguish too deep for tears in her eyes. For was not this the end, the very end? Fierce, dry sobs shook her. There was something terrible and tigerish in her grief, and yet her will made her not linger. There was still one thing to do. She rose and turned to the writing-table by the window. Then, drawing the blind aside a little, she began rapidly to write. When she had finished without reading the missive over, she went and placed it with a flat leather jewel case on her pillow beside Paul. And soon she commenced a madness of farewells, all restrained and gentle, for fear he should awake. "My love, my love," she wailed between her kisses, "God keep you safe, though he may never bring you back to me." Then, with a wild, strangled sob, she fled from the room. End of chapter 19.
Chapter 20 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 20. A hush was over everything when Paul first awoke. The hush of a hot, drowsy noontide. He stretched out his arm to touch his loved one, as was his custom, to draw her near and envelope her with caresses and greeting, an instinct which came to him while yet half asleep. But his arm met empty space. What is this? He opened his eyes wide and sat up in bed. He was alone. Where had she gone? He had slept so late, that was it. She was playing one of her sweet tricks upon him. Perhaps she was even hiding behind the curtain which covered the entrance to the side loggia where they were accustomed to breakfast. He would look and see. He rose quickly and lifted the heavy drapery. No, the loggia was untenanted, and breakfast was laid for one. That was the first chill, for one. Was she angry at his drowsiness? Good God, what could it mean? He staggered a little and sat on the bed, clutching the fine sheet. And as he did so, it disclosed the letter and the flat leather case, which had fallen from the pillow and become hidden in the clothes. A deadly faintness came over Paul. For a few seconds he trembled, so his shaking fingers refused to hold the paper. Then, with a mighty effort, he mastered himself, and tearing the envelope open, began to read. It was a wonderful letter. The last passionate cry of her great loving heart. It passed in review their glorious days in burning woods from the first moment of their meeting. And then, towards the end, "My Paul," she wrote, "that first night you were my caprice and afterwards my love. But now you are my life, and for this I must leave you to save that life, sweet lover. Seek me not, heart of my heart. Believe me, I would not go if there were any other way. Fate is too strong for us, and I must bow my head. Were I to remain even another hour, all Dmitri's watching could not keep you safe. Darling, while I thought they menaced only me alone, it only angered me, but now I know that you would pay the penalty. I can but go. If you follow me, it will mean the death for us both. Oh, Paul, I implore you, by our great love, go into safety as soon as you can. You must leave Venice and return straight to England and your home. Darling, beloved, lover, if we never meet again in this sad world, let this thought stay with you always, that I love you, heart and mind, body and soul. I am utterly and forever yours." As he read the last words, the room became dark for Paul. He fell back like a log on the bed, the paper fluttering to the floor from his nerveless fingers. She was gone, and life, it seemed, over for him. Here, perhaps an hour later, Thompson found him still unconscious, and in terrified haste sent off for a doctor, and telegraphed Sir Charles Verdane. "Come at once, Thompson." But ere his father could arrive on Sunday, Paul was lying, twixt life and death, madly raving with brain fever. And thus ended the 3 weeks of his episode. The end of chapter 20.
Chapter 21 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kathleen. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 21. Have any of you who read crept back to life from nearly beyond the grave? Crept back to find it shorn of all that made it fair? After hours of delirium to awaken in great weakness to a sense of hideous anguish and loss? To the prospect of days of aching void and hopeless longing? To the hourly, momentary sting of remembrance of things vaster than death, more dear than life itself? If you have come through this valley of the shadow, then you can know what the first days of returning consciousness meant to Paul. He never really questioned the finality of her decree. He sensed it meant parting for ever. And yet, with that spring of eternal hope which animates all living souls, unbidden arguings and possibilities rose in his enfeebled brain and deepened his unrest. Thus his progress towards convalescence was long and slow. And all this time his father and Thompson had nursed him in the old Venetian palazzo with tenderest devotion. The Italian servants had been left, paid up for a month, but the lady and her Russian retinue had vanished, leaving no trace. Both Thompson and Sir Charles knew almost the whole story now from Paul's ravings, and neither spoke of it, except that Thompson supplied some links to complete Sir Charles's picture. She was the most splendid lady you could wish to see, Sir Charles, the stolid creature finished with. Her servants worshipped her, and if Mr. Verdani is now ill, he is ill for no less than a queen. This fact comforted Thompson greatly, but Paul's father found in it no consolation. The difficulty had been to prevent his mother from descending upon them. She must ever be kept in ignorance of this episode in her son's life. She belonged to the class of intellect which could never have understood. It would have been an undying shock and horrified grief to the end of her life. Excellent, loving, conventional lady. So after the first terrible danger was over, Sir Charles made light of their son's illness. Paul and he were enjoying Venice, he said, and would soon be home. D-blank-D. Hard luck, the boy getting fever like this. He wrote in his laconic style, but one never could trust foreign countries' drains. And the Lady Henrietta waited in unsuspecting, well-bred patience. Those were weary days for every one concerned. It wrung his father's heart to see Paul prostrate there, as weak as an infant, all his splendid youth and strength conquered by this raging blast. It was sad to have to listen to his ever-constant moan, "Darling, come back to me. Darling, my queen." And even after he regained consciousness, it was equally pitiful to watch him lying nerveless and white, blue shadows on his once fresh skin. And most pitiful of all were his hands, now veined and transparent, falling idly upon the sheet. But at least the father realized it could have been no ordinary woman whose going caused the shock which, even after a life of 3 weeks' continual emotion, could prostrate his young Hercules. She must have been worth something, this tiger queen. And one day, contrary to his usual custom, he addressed Thompson. "What sort of a looking woman, Thompson?" And Thompson, although an English valet, did not reply. "Who, Sir Charles?" He just rounded his eyes stolidly and said in his monotonous voice, "She was that forcible looking, a man couldn't say when he got close. She kind of dazzled him. She had black hair and a white face, and witch's eyes, but she was very kind and overpowering, haughty and generous. Any one would have known she was a queen." "Young?" asked Sir Charles. Thompson smoothed his chin. "I could not say, Sir Charles. Some days about 25, and other days past 30, about 33 to 35. I expect she was, if the truth were known." "Pretty?" The eyes rounded more and more. "Well, she was so fascinating, I can't say, Sir Charles. The most lovely lady I ever did see at times, Sir Charles." "Humph," said Paul's father, and then relapsed into silence. "She'd a beast of a husband. He might have been a king, but he was no gentleman," Thompson ventured to add presently, fearing the "humph" perhaps meant disapprobation of this splendid queen. "Her servants were close and did not speak good English, so I could not get much out of them. But the man Vasily, who came the last days, did say in a funny lingo, which I had to guess at, as how he expected he should have to kill him some time. Vasily had a scar on his face as long as your finger that he'd got defending the queen from her husband's brutality when he was the worst for drink only last year. And Mr. Verdenay is so handsome. It is no wonder, Sir Charles." "That will do, Thompson," said Sir Charles, and he frowned. The fatal letter, carefully sealed up in a new envelope, and the leather case were in his dispatch box. Thompson had handed them to him on his arrival, and one day when Paul appeared well enough to be lifted into a long chair on the side loggia, his father thought fit to give them to him. Paul's apathy seemed paralyzing. The days had passed since the little Italian doctor had pronounced him out of danger. In one unending, languid quietude, he expressed interest in no single thing. He was polite and indifferent and numb. "He must be rousted now," Sir Charles said to the doctor. "It is too hot for Venice. He must be moved to higher air." And the little man had nodded his head. So this warm late afternoon, as he lay under the mosquito curtains, which the coming of June had made necessary in this paradise, his father said to him, "I have a letter and a parcel of yours, Paul. You had better look at them. We hope to start north in a day or two. You must get to a more bracing place." Then he had pushed them under the net folds and turned his back on the scene. The blood rushed to Paul's face, but left him deathly pale after a few moments, and presently he broke the seal. The minute sphinx in the corner of the paper seemed to mock at him. Indeed, life was a riddle of anguish and pain. He read the letter all over, and read it again. The passionate words of love warmed him now that he had passed the agony of the farewell. One sentence he had hardly grasped before, in particular, held balm. "Sweetheart," it said, "you must not grieve. Think always of the future and of our hope. Our love is not dead with our parting, and one day there will be the living sign." Yes, that thought was comfort, but how should he know? Then he turned to the leather case. His fingers were still so feeble that with difficulty he pressed the spring to open it. He glanced up at his father's distinguished looking back outlined against the loggia's opening arches. It appeared uncompromising. A fixed determination to stare at the oleanders below seemed the only spirit animating this parent. Yes, he must open the box. It gave suddenly with a jerk, and there lay a dog's collar, made of small, flexible plates of pure beaten gold, mounted on Russian leather, all of the finest workmanship. And on a slip of paper in his darling's own writing he read, "This is for Pike, my beloved one. Let him wear it always, a gift from me." On the collar itself, finely engraved, were the words, "Pike, belonging to Paul Verdenay." Then the floodgates of Paul's numbed soul were opened. A great sob rose in his breast. He covered his face with his hands and cried like a child. Oh, her dear thought, her dear, tender thought, for Pike, his little friend. And Sir Charles made believe he saw nothing, as he stole from the place, his rugged face twitching a little, and his keen eyes dim. End of chapter 21. Chapter 22 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kathleen. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 22. They did not go north, as Sir Charles intended. An unaccountable reluctance on Paul's part to return through Switzerland changed their plans. Instead, by a fortunate chance, the large schooner yacht of a rather eccentric old friend came into Venice, and the father eagerly accepted the invitation to go on board and bring his invalid. The owner, one Captain Grigsby, had been quite alone, so the three men would be in peace, and nothing could be better for Paul than this warm sea air. "Typhoid fever?" Mark Grigsby had asked. "No," Sir Charles had replied. "Considerable mental tribulation over a woman. D-blank-D. Kittle-cattle," was Captain Grigsby's polite comment. "A fine boy, too, and promising. Appears to have been almost worthwhile," Sir Charles added, "from what I gather. And, confound it, Grig, we'd have done the same in our day." But Captain Grigsby only repeated, "D-blank-D, kittle-kettle," and so they weighed anchor and sailed along the Italian shores of the sunlit Adriatic. These were better days for Paul. Each hour brought him back some health and vigor. Youth and strength were asserting their own again, and the absence of familiar objects and the glory of the air and the blue sea helped sometimes to deaden the poignant agony of his aching heart. But there it was underneath, an ever-present dull anguish, and only when he became sufficiently strong to help the sailors with the ropes and exert physical force did he get one moment's respite. The two elder men watched him with kind, furtive eyes, but they never questioned him or made the slightest allusion to his travels. And the first day they heard him laugh, Sir Charles looked down at the white foam because a mist was in his eyes. They had coasted round Italy and Sicily, and not among the Ionian Isles, as had been Captain Grigsby's intention. "I fancy the lady came from some of those Balkan countries," Sir Charles had said. "Don't let us get in touch with even the outside of one of them." And Mark Grigsby had grunted an assent. "The boy is a fine fellow," he said one morning as they looked at Paul hauling ropes. "He'll probably never get quite over this, but he is fighting like a man, Charles. Tell me as much as you feel inclined to of the story." So Sir Charles began in his short, broken sentences. "Parson's girl to start with. Sympathy over a broken collarbone. The wife behaved unwisely about it, so the boy thought he was in love. We sent him to travel to get rid of that idea. It appears he met this lady in Lucerne. Seems to have been an exceptional person. A Russian, Thompson says. A queen or princess incog, the fellow tells me, but I can't spot her as yet. Hubert will know who she was, though, but it does not matter. The woman herself was the thing. Gather she was quite a remarkable woman, 10 years older than Paul. Always the case," growled Captain Grigsby. Sir Charles puffed at his pipe, and then, "They were only together 3 weeks," he said, "and during that time she managed to cram more knowledge of everything into the boy's head than you and I have got in a lifetime. Give you my word, Grig, when he was off his chump in the fever, he raved like a poet and an orator, and he was only an ordinary sportsman when he left home in the spring. Cleopatra, he called her one day, and I fancy that was the keynote. She must have been one of those exceptional women we read of in the sixth form." "And fortunately never met," said Captain Grigsby. "I don't know," mused Sir Charles. "It might have been good to live as wildly, even at the price. We've both been about the world, Grig, since the days we fastened on our cuirasses together for the first time, and each thought himself the devil of a fine fellow. But I rather doubt if we now know as much of what is really worth having as my boy there, just 23 years old." "Nonsense," snapped Captain Grigsby, but there was a tone of regret in his protest. "Lucky to have got off without a knife or a bullet through him. Dangerous nations to grapple with," he said. "Yes, I gather some pretty heavy menace was over their heads, and that is what made the lady decamp. So we've got much to be thankful for," agreed Sir Charles. "Had she any children?" the other asked. "Thompson says no. Rotten fellow, the husband, it appears, and no heir to the throne, or principality, or whatever it is. So when I have had a talk with Hubert, Henrietta's brother, you know, the one in the diplomatic service, it will be easy to locate her. Gathered Paul doesn't know himself. Pretty romance, anyway. And what will you do with the boy now, Charles?" Paul's father puffed quite a long while at his meerschaum before he answered, and then his voice was gruffer than ever, with tenderness suppressed. "Give him his head, Grig," he said. "He's true blue underneath, and he'll come up to the collar in time, old friend. Only I have to keep his mother's love from harrying him. Best and greatest lady in the world, my wife, but she's rather apt to jog the bridle now and then. At this moment Paul joined them. His paleness showed less than usual beneath the sunburn, and his eyes seemed almost bright. A wave of thankful gladness filled his father's heart. "Thank God," he said, below his breath. "Thank God." The weather had been perfection, hardly a drop of rain, and just the gentlest breezes to waft them slowly along. A suitable, soothing, idle life for one who had but lately been near death. And each day Paul's strength returned, until his father began to hope they might still be home for his birthday, the last day of July. They had crept up the coast of Italy now, when an absolute calm fell upon them, and just opposite the temple of Paestum they decided to anchor for the night. For the last evenings, as the moon had grown larger, Paul had been strangely restless. It seemed as if he preferred to tire himself out with unnecessary rope-pulling, and then retire to his berth the moment that dinner was over, rather than go on deck. His face, too, which had been controlled as a mask until now, wore a look of haunting anguish which was grievous to see. He ate his dinner, or rather pretended to play with the food, in absolute silence. Uneasiness overcame Sir Charles, and he glanced at his old friend, but Paul, after lighting a cigar, and letting it out once or twice, rose, and, murmuring something about the heat, went up on deck. It was the night of the full moon, 8 weeks exactly since the joy of life had finished for him. He felt he could not bear even the two kindly gentlemen whose unspoken sympathy he knew was his. He could not bear anything human. Tonight, at least, he must be alone with his grief. All nature was in a mood divine. They were close enough inshore to see the splendid temples clearly with the naked eye. The sky and the sea were of the color only the Mediterranean knows. It was hot and still, and the moon, in her pure magnificence, cast her never-ending spell. Not a sound of the faintest ripple met his ear. The sailors supped below. All was silent. On one side the vast sea, on the other the shore. With this masterpiece of man's genius, the temple of the great god Poseidon, in this vanished settlement of the old Greeks, how marvelously beautiful it all was, and how his queen would have loved it, how she would have told him its history and woven round it the spirit of the past, until his living eyes could almost have seen the priests and the people, and heard their worshipping prayers. His darling had spoken of it once, he remembered, and had told him it was a place they must see. He recollected her very words. "We must look at it first in the winter from the shore, my Paul, and see those splendid proportions outlined against the sky, so noble and so perfectly balanced. And then we must see it from the sea, with the background of the olive hills. It is ever silent and deserted and calm, and death lurks there after the month of March. A cruel malaria, which we must not face, dear love. But if we could, we ought to see it from a yacht in safety in the summer time, and then the spell would fall upon us, and we would know it was true that rose trees really grew there, which gave the world their blossoms twice a year. That was the legend of the Greeks. Well, he was seeing it from a yacht. But ah, God, seeing it alone, alone, and where was she? So intense and vivid was his remembrance of her that he could feel her presence near. If he turned his head, he felt he should see her standing beside him, her strange eyes full of love. The very perfume of her seemed to fill the air, her golden voice to whisper in his ear, her soul to mingle with his soul. Ah, yes, in spirit, as she had said, they would never be parted more. A suppressed moan of anguish escaped his lips, and his father, who had come silently behind him, put his hand on his arm. "My poor boy," he said, his gruff voice hoarse in his throat, "if only to God I could do something for you." "Oh, father," said Paul, and the two men looked in each other's eyes and knew each other as never before. End of chapter 22. Chapter 23 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Kathleen. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 23. Next day there was a fresh breeze, and they scudded before it on to Naples. Here Paul seemed well enough to take train, and so arrive in England in time for his birthday. He owed this to his mother, he and his father both felt. She had been looking forward to it for so long, as at the time of his coming of age the festivities had been interrupted by the sudden death of his maternal grandfather, and the people had all been promised a continuance of them on this, his 23rd birthday. So, taking the journey by sufficiently easy stages, sleeping 3 nights on the way, they calculated to arrive on the eve of the event. The Lady Henrietta would have everything in readiness for them, and her darling Paul was not to be overhurried. Only guests of the most congenial kind had been invited, and such a number of nice girls. The prospect was perfectly delightful, and ought to cause any young man pure joy. It was with a heart as heavy as lead Paul mounted the broad steps of his ancestral home that summer evening, and was folded in his mother's arms. The guests were all fortunately dressing for dinner. Captain Grigsby had been persuaded to abandon his yacht and accompany them too. "Yes, I'll come, Charles," he said, "getting too confoundedly hot in these seas. Besides, the boy will want more than one to see him through among those cackling women." So the three had traveled together through Italy and France. Switzerland had been strictly avoided. "Paul, darling," his mother exclaimed, in a voice of pained surprise, as she stood back and looked at him. "But surely you have been very ill, my darling, darling son." "I told you he had had a sharp attack of fever, Henrietta," interrupted Sir Charles quickly, "and no one looks their best after traveling in this grilling weather. Let the boy get to his bath, and you will see a different person." But his mother's loving eyes were not to be deceived. So with infinite fuss and terms of endearment, she insisted upon accompanying her offspring to his room, where the dignified housekeeper was summoned, and his very imaginable and unimaginable want arranged to be supplied. Once all this would have irritated Paul to the verge of bearish rudeness, but now he only kissed his mother's white jeweled hand. He remembered his lady's tender counsel to him, given in one of their many talks. "You must always reverence your mother, Paul, and accept her worship with love." So now he said, "Dear mother, it is so good of you, but I'm all right. Fever does knock one over a bit, you know. You'll see, though, being at home again will make me perfectly well in no time, and I'll be as good as you like, and eat and drink all Mrs. Elwyn's beef teas and jellies, and other beastly stuff, if you will just let me dress now, like a darling." However, his mother was obliged to examine and assure herself that his beautiful hair was still thick and waving, and she had to pause and sigh over every sharpened line of his face and figure. Though the thought of being permitted to lavish continuous care for long days to come held a certain consolation for her. At last, Paul was left alone, and there came a moment he had been longing for. He had sent written orders that Tremlett should bring Pike and leave him in his dressing room beyond, and all the while his mother had talked he had heard suppressed whines and scratchings. Somehow he had not wanted to see his dog before any of the people. The greeting between himself and his little friend must be in solitude, for was there not a secret link between them in that golden collar given by his queen? And Pike would understand, he certainly would understand, if short, passionate barks and a madness of wagging tail stump, accompanied by jumps of crazy joy, could comfort anyone. Then Paul had his measure when the door was opened, and this rough white terrier bounded in upon him, and, frantic with welcome and ecstasy, was with difficulty quieted at last in his master's fond arms. "Oh, Pike, Pike," Paul said, while tears of weakness flowed down his cheeks, "I can talk to you, and when you wear her collar you will know my queen, our queen." And Pike said everything of sympathy a dog could say. But it was not until late at night, when the interminable evening had been got through, that his master had the pleasure of trying his darling's present on. That first evening of his homecoming was an ordeal for Paul. He was still feeble and dead tired from traveling, to begin with, and to have to listen and reply to the endless banalities of his mother's guests was almost more than he could bear. They were a nice, cheery company of mostly young friends. Pretty girls and his own boon companions abounded, and they chaffed and played silly games after dinner, until Paul could have groaned. Captain Grigsby had eventually caught Sir Charles's eye. "You will have the boy fainting if you don't get him off alone soon," he said. "These girls would tire a man in strong health." And at last Paul had escaped to his own room. He leant out of his window and looked at the gibbous moon. Pike was there on the broad sill beside him, under his arm, and he could feel the golden collar on the soft fur neck. A wave of perhaps the most hopeless anguish he had yet felt was upon his spirit now. The unutterable blankness, the impossible vista of the endless days to come, with no prospect of meeting, no aim, no hope. Yes, she had said there was one hope that could bring peace to their crud unrest. But how and when should he ever know? And if it were so, then more than ever he should be by her side. The number of beautiful things he would want to say to her about it all, the oceans of love he would desire to pour upon her, the tender care which should be his hourly joy, to honor and worship her and chase all pain away. And he did not even know her name, or the country where one day this hope should reign. That was incredible, and it would be so easy to find out. But he had promised her never to make inquiries, and he would keep his word. He saw her reason now. It had arisen in an instinct of tender protection for himself. She had known if he knew her place of abode, no fear of death would keep him from trying to see her. Ah, he had had the tears. And why not the cold steel and blood? It was no price to pay could he but hear once more her golden voice and feel her loving, twining arms. He was only held back by the fear of danger for her, and instead of being with her and waiting on her footsteps, he should have to spend his next hours with those ridiculous English women, those foolish, flippant girls. One had quoted poetry to him at dinner, the very scrap his lady had spoken a line of. This new poet, who was taking the world of London by storm that year, loved with a love beyond all words or sense, and it had sounded like pathos or sacrilege. What did these dolls know of love or life? Chattering parrots to weary a man's brain. Yes, the Greeks were right. It would be better to keep them spinning flax and uneducated. And so in his young intolerance, maddened by pain, he saw all things gibbous like the mocking moon. Pike stirred under his arm and licked his hand, a faint whine of love making itself heard in the night. "Oh, God," said Paul, as he buried his face in his hands, "let me get through this time as she would have me to. Let it not show the anguish in my heart, but be at least a man and gentle man." End of chapter 23.
Chapter 24 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 24. The neighbours and his parents were astonished at the eloquence of Paul's speech at the great dinner given to the tenants next day. No one had guessed at his powers before, and the county papers, and indeed some London reporters, had predicted a splendid political future for this young orator. It had been quite a long speech, and contained sound arguments and common sense, and was expressed in language so lofty and refined that it sent ecstatic admiration through his mother's fond breast. And all the time Paul spoke, he saw no sea of faces below him. Only his soul's eyes were looking into those strange chameleon orbs of his lady. He said every word as if she had been there, and at the end it almost seemed she must have heard him, so soft a peace fell on his spirit. Yes, she would have been pleased with her lover, he knew, and that held large grains of consolation. And so these days passed in well-accomplished duty, and at last all the festivities were over, and he could rest. Captain Grigsby and his father had helped him whenever they could, and an eternal bond of friendship was cemented between the three.
"By Jove, Charles,
"You ought to be thundering proud of that boy," Captain Grigsby said, the morning of his departure for Scotland on August the 10th. "He's come up to the scratch like a hero, and whatever the damage, the lady must have been well worth while to turn him out polished like that. Gad, Charles, I'd take a month's journey to see her myself." And Paul's father grunted with satisfaction as he said, "I told you so." Thus the summer days went by in the strengthening of Paul's character, trying always to live up to an ideal, trying ever to dominate his grief, but never trying to forget. By the autumn shooting time, his health was quite restored, and except that he looked a year or so older, there were no outward traces of the passing through that valley of the shadow from whence he had escaped with just his life. But the 3 weeks of his lady's influence had changed the inner man beyond all recognition. His spirit was stamped with her nameless distinction, and all the vistas she had opened for him to the tree of knowledge he now followed up. No smallest incident of his day seemed unconnected with some thought or wish of hers, so that in truth she still guided and moulded him by the power of her great soul. But in spite of all these things, the weeks and months held hours of aching longing and increasing anxiety to know how she fared. If she should be ill, if their hope was coming true, then now she must be suffering, and suffering all alone. Sometimes the agony of the thought was more than Paul could bear, and took him off with Pike alone into the leafless woods which crowned a hill at the top of the park. And then he would pause and look out at the view and the dull November sky, a madness of agonizing unrest torturing his heart. The one thing he felt glad of was the absence of his Uncle Hubert, who had been made minister in a South American republic, and would not return to England for more than a year. So there would be no temptation to question him, or perchance to hear one of his clever, evil jests which might contain some allusion to his lady. Lord Hubert Altringham was fond of boasting of his royal acquaintances, and was of a mind that found not even Lancelot brave, nor Galahad clean. Now all Paul could do was to wait and hope. At least his queen had his address. She could write to him, even though he could not write to her. And surely, surely some news of her must come. Thus the winter arrived, and the hunting. Hunting that he had been sure was what he liked best in all the world. And now it just served to pass the time and distract some hours from the anguishing ache by its physical pleasure. But in that, as in everything he did at this time, Paul tried to outshine his fellows and gain one more laurel to lay at the feet of his queen. Socially, he was having an immense success. He began to be known as someone worth listening to by men, and women hung on his words. It was peculiarly delightful to find so young and beautiful a creature with all the knowledge and fascinating cachet of a man of the world. And then his complete indifference to them piqued and allured them still more. Always polite and chivalrous, but as aloof as a mountain top. Paul had no small vanity to be soothed by their worship into forgetting for one moment his queen. So his shooting visits passed, and his experience of life grew. Isabella had returned at Christmas, engaged to a high church curate, and beaming with satisfaction and health. And it gave Paul, and indeed them both, pleasure to meet and talk for an hour. She was a good sort always, and if he marvelled to himself how he had even been even mildly attracted by her, he did not let it appear in his manner. but one thing jarred. "My goodness, Paul, how smart Pike's collar is," Isabella had said. "Did you ever? You extravagant boy! It is good enough for a lady's bracelet. You had better give it to me. It will make the finest wedding gift I'll have." But Paul had snatched Pike up, the blood burning in his cheeks, and had laughed awkwardly and turned the conversation. No one's fingers but his own were ever allowed to touch the sacred gold. About this time, his mother began to have the idea he ought really to marry. His father had been 30 at the time of his wedding with herself, and she had always thought that was starting too late. 23 was a good age, and a sweet, gentle wife of Paul's would be the joy of her declining years, to say nothing of several grandchildren. But when this matter was broached to him first, Paul laughed, and when it became a daily subject of conversation, he almost lost that quick temper of his, which was not quite yet under control. "I tell you what it is, mother," he said. "If you tease me like this, I shall go away on a voyage round the world." So the Lady Henrietta subsided into pained silence, and sulked with her adored son for more than a day. "Paul is so unaccountably changed since his visit abroad," she said to her husband plaintively. "I sometimes wonder, Charles, if we really know all the people he met." And Sir Charles had replied, "Nonsense, Henrietta. The lad is a man now, and immensely improved. Do leave him in peace." But when he was alone, the father had smiled to himself rather sadly, for he saw a good deal with his shrewd eyes, though he said no words of sympathy to his son. He knew that Paul was suffering still, perhaps as keenly as ever, and he honoured his determination to keep it all from view. So the old year died, and the new one came, and soon February would be here. Oh, with what passionate anxiety the end of that month was awaited by Paul! Only his own heart knew. End of chapter 24. Chapter 25 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 25. The days passed on. March had almost come, and Paul heard nothing. His father noticed the daily look of strain, and his mother anxiously inquired if he were dull, and if he would not like her to have some people to stay, and thus divert him in some fashion. And Paul had answered with what grace he could. An intense temptation came over him to read all the court news. He longed to pick up the ladies' papers he saw in his mother's sitting-room. Such journals, he knew, delighted to publish the doings of royal lives. But the stern self-control which now he practised in all the ruling of his life prevented him. No, he had promised never to investigate, and neither in the letter nor the spirit would he break his word, whatever the suffering. The news, when it came, must be from his beloved one direct. But oh, the unrest of these hours! Had their hope come true? And how was she? The days passed in annoying anxiety. He was so restless he could hardly fix his attention on anything. It required the whole of his will to keep him taking in the sense of the parliamentary books which were now his study. The constant query would raise its head between each page. What news of my queen? What news of my queen? Each mail as it came in made his heart beat, and often his hand trembled as he lifted his pile of letters. But no sight of her writing gladdened his eyes, until he began to be like the sea with its tides, rising twice a day in a rushing hope with the posts, and sinking again in disappointment. He grew to look haggard, and his father's heart ached for him in silence. At length, one morning, when he had almost trained himself not to glance at his correspondence, which came as he was dawdling over an early breakfast, his eye caught a foreign-looking letter lying on the top. It was no hand he knew, but something told him it contained a message from his queen. He dominated himself. He would not even look at the postmark until he was away up in his own room. No eye but Pike's must see his joy, or sorrow and disappointment. And so the letter burnt in his pocket until his sanctum was reached, and then with agonized impatience he opened the envelope. Within was another, of the familiar paper he knew. And, oh, thank God, addressed in pencil in his lady's own hand. Inside it contained an enclosure, but the sheet was blank. With wildly beating heart and trembling fingers, Paul undid the smaller packet's folded ends. And there the morning sunbeams fell on a tiny curl of hair, of that peculiar nondescript shade of infant fairness, which later would turn to gold. It was less than an inch long, and of the fineness of down, while in tender care it had been tied with a thread of blue silk. Written on the paper underneath were the words, "Beloved, he is so strong and fair, thy son, born the 19th of February." For a moment Paul closed his eyes, and as once before a choir of seraphims was singing in his ears. Then he looked at this minute lock again, and touched it with his forefinger. The strangest emotion he had ever known quivered through his being. The concentrated sensation of what he used to feel when his lady had spoken of their hope. A weird, tremulous physical thrill. The dear small curl of hair. The actual, tangible proof of his own living son. He lifted it with the greatest reverence to his lips, and a mist of joy swam in his blue eyes. Oh, it was all too wonderful, too divine, the thought. The essence of their great love, this child of his and hers. Yes, their hope had not deceived them. It was true, it was true. Then his mind rose in a passionate worship of his lady, his goddess and queen, the mainspring of his watch of life, the supreme and absolute mistress of his heart and soul. Never had he more madly desired and loved her than this day. He kissed and kissed her words in deep devotion. But how and where was she? Was she well? Was she ill? Had she been suffering? Oh, that he could fly to her! More than ever the terrible gall of their separation came to him. It was his right by every law of nature to now be by her side. But she was well. She must be well, or she would have said. And surely he soon would see her. It was like a voice from heaven, her little written words, bridging the impossible, drawing him back to the knowledge and certainty that she was there for him to love and one day to go to. Fate could never be so unjust as to part him from the mother of his child. And then A state of mad ecstasy came over Paul with that vision. He could not stay in the house. He must go out under God's sky and let his soul thoughts fly into space. Dazzling pictures came to him. Surely the spring was in his heart, breaking through the frozen ground, like a single golden crocus he saw at his feet. Surely, surely the sun of life would shine again, and living he should see her. He strode away, Pike gambling beside him, and racing head and back again, seeming to understand and participate in his master's inward joy. Paul hardly noticed where he went, his thoughts exalting him so that he did not even heed to choose his favourite haunt, the wood against the skyline. It was as if great blocks of icy fear and anguish were melting in the warmth. Hope and glory shone on his path, almost blinding him. He left the park far behind, and struck away across the moor. As he passed some gypsy vans, a swarthy young woman looked out, an infant in her arms, and gave him a smiling greeting. But Paul stopped and said good day, tossing her a sovereign with laughing, cheery words for her little child, and so passed on, his glad face radiant as the morn. But the woman called after him in gratitude. "Blessings, Your Honour! Your own will grace a throne." And the strange coincidence of her prophecy set fresh thrills of delight bounding in Paul's veins. He walked and walked, stopping to lunch at an inn miles away. He could not bear even to see his parents, or the familiar scenes at home. And as once before he had felt in his grief, he and his joy must be alone today. When he turned to come back in the late afternoon, the torrent of his wild happiness had crystallized itself into coherent thought and question. Surely she would send him some more words, and make some plan to see him. But at least he was in touch with her again, and knew she was his own, his own. The silence had broken, and human ingenuity would find some way of meeting. The postmark was Vienna, though that meant nothing at all. She could have sent Dmitri there to post the letter. But at best, even if it were Russia, a few days' journey only separated him from his darling and his son. Then the realization of that proud fact of parenthood came over him again. He said the words aloud, "My son!" And with a cry of wild exultation he vaulted a gate, like a schoolboy, and ran along the path, Pike bounding in the air in frantic sympathy. Thus Paul returned to his home again, hope singing in his heart. But even his father did not guess why that night at dinner. He raised his champagne glass and drank a silent toast, his eyes gazing into distance as if he there saw heaven. End of chapter 25.
Chapter 26 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Amy Deutschler. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 26. Of course, as the days went by, the sparkle of Paul's joy subsided. An infinite unrest took its place. A continual mad desire for further news. Supposing she were ill, his darling one. Many times a day he read her words. The pencil writing was certainly feeble and shaky. Supposing, but he refused to face any terrible picture. The letter had come on the 2nd of March. His son had been 11 days old then, 2 days and a half to Vienna. That brought it to 8 when the letter was posted. And from whence had it come there? If he allowed 2 days more, say, she must have written it only 5 or 6 days after the baby's birth. Paul knew very little about such things, though he understood vaguely that a woman might possibly be very ill even after then. But surely, if so, Anna or Dmitri would have told him on their own initiative. This thought comforted him a little, but still anxiety, like a sleuth-hound, pursued his every moment. He would not leave home. London saw him not even for a day. Some word might come in his absence, some message or summons to go to her, and he would not chance being out of its reach. More than ever, all their 3 weeks of happiness was lived over again. Every word she had said had sunk forever in his memory. And away in his solitary walks or his rides home from hunting in the dusk of the afternoon, he let them echo in his heart. But the desire to be near her was growing an obsession. Some days when a wild gallop had made his blood run, triumphant thoughts of his son would come to him. How he should love to teach him to sit a horse in days to come, to ride to hounds and shoot and be an English gentleman. Oh, why was she a queen, his loved one, and far away? Why not here, and his wife, whom he could cover with devotion and honor? Surely that would be enough for them both. A life of trust and love and sweetness. But even if it were not, there was the world to choose from, if only they were together. The two, Paul and his father, were a silent pair for the most part, as they jogged along the lanes on their way back from hunting. One afternoon, when this sense of parenthood was strong upon Paul, he went into tea in his mother's sitting-room. And as he leant upon the mantelpiece, his tall, splendid figure in its scarlet coat outlined against the bright blaze, his eye took in, perhaps for the first time, the immense number of portraits of himself which decorated this apartment, himself in every stage, from infantile days upward, through the toy rocking horse period to the real dog companion, in Eton collars and 4th of June hats, in cricketing flannels and Oxford Bullington groups, and then not so many, until one taken last year. How young it looked and smiling! There was one particular miniature of him in the holy of holiest positions in the center of the writing table, a real work of art, well painted on ivory. It was mounted in a frame of fine pearls and engraved with the name and date at the back, Paul Verdane. Aged 5 years and 3 months. It was a full-length picture of him standing next a great chair, in a blue velvet suit and a lace turnover collar, while curls of brightest gold fell rippling to his neck, rather short, bunchy curls which evidently would not be repressed. "Was I ever like that, mother?" he said. And the Lady Henrietta, only too enchanted to expand upon this enthralling subject, launched forth on a full description. Like it, of course, only much more beautiful. No child had ever had such golden curls, or such eyes or eyelashes. No child had ever, in fact, been able to compare with him in any way, or ever would. The Lady Henrietta's delicate shell-tinted cheeks flushed rose with joy at the recollection. "Darling mother," said Paul, as he kissed her, "how you loved me, and how cold I have often been. Forgive me." Then he was silent while she fondled him in peace, his thoughts turning as ever to his lady. She, too, probably would be foolish and tender and sweet over her son. And how his mother would love her grandchild. Oh, how cruel was fate! Then he asked, "Mother, Does it take women a long time to get well when they have children? Ladies, I mean, who are finely nurtured? They generally get well, though, don't they? And it is quite simple." And the Lady Henrietta blushed as she answered, "Oh, yes, quite simple, unless some complications occur. Of course, there is always a faint danger, and then it is so well worth it. What a strange thing to ask, though, dear boy. Were you thinking of Cousin Agatha?" "Cousin Agatha," said Paul vaguely, and then recollected himself. "Oh, yes, of course. How is she?" But when he went off to his room to change, his mother's words stayed with him. "Unless some complications occur," and the thought opened a fresh field of anxious wonderment. At last it all seemed unbearable. A wild idea of rushing off to Vienna came to him, to rush there on the clue of a postmark. But common sense put this aside. It might be the means of just missing some message. No, he must bear things and wait. This silence, perhaps, meant good news, and if by the end of April nothing came, then he should have to break his promise and investigate. About this time, Captain Grigsby again came to stay with them, and the next day, as he and his host smoked their pipes while they walked up and down the sunny terrace, he took occasion to give forth this information.
"I say, Charles, I have located her. Have you?"
"No, by Jove," said Paul's father. "Hubert is away, you know, and I have just let the thing slide."
"About the end of February, did you notice the boy looking at all worried?"
Sir Charles thought a moment.
"Yes, I recollect, damned worried and restless, and he is again now." "Ah, I thought so,"
said Mark Grigsby, as though he could say a good deal more.
"Well, then, out with it, Grig," Sir Charles said impatiently.
And Captain Grigsby proceeded in his own style to weave together a chain of coincidences which had struck him until this final certainty. They were a clear set of arguments, and Paul's father was convinced, too.
"You see, Thompson told you in the beginning she was Russian," Captain Grigsby said after talking for some time, "and the rest was easy to find out. We're not here to judge the morals of the affair, Charles. You and I can only be thundering glad your grandson will sit on the throne all right."
He had read in one paper, he proceeded to say, that a most difficult political situation had been avoided by the birth of this child, as there was no possible heir at all, and immense complications would ensue upon the death of the present ruler. The scurrilous rag even gave a resume of this ruler's dissolute life, and a broad hint that the child could in no case be his. But, as they pithily remarked, this added to the little prince's welcome in ministerial circles, where the lady was greatly beloved and revered, and the king had only been put upon his tottering throne and kept there by the fact of being her husband. The paper added the king had taken the chief part in the rejoicings over the heir, so there was nothing to be said. There were hints also of his mad fits of debauchery and drunkenness, and a suppressed tale of how in one of them he had strangled a keeper and had often threatened the queen's life. Her brother, however, was with her now, and would see Russian supremacy was not upset.
"Husband seems a likely character to hobnob with, don't he, Charles? No wonder she turned her eye on Paul, eh?"
Mark Grigsby ended with. But Sir Charles answered not. His thoughts were full of his son. All the forces of nature and emotion seemed to be drawing him away from peaceful England towards a hornet's nest, and he, his father, would be powerless to prevent it. End of chapter 26. Chapter 27 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Amy Deutschler. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 27. April's days were lengthening out in showers and sunshine and cold east wind. Easter and a huge party had come and gone at Verdane Place, and the Lady Henrietta had had her hopes once more blighted by noticing Paul's indomitable indifference to all the pretty girls. He was going to stand for Parliament in the autumn, when their very old member should retire, and he made that an excuse for his isolation. He was working too hard for social functions, he said. But in reality life was growing more than he could bear. Captain Grigsby had sold the old blue heather and bought a new steam yacht of 700 tons, large enough to take him round the world, he said, and he had had her put in commission for the Mediterranean, and she was waiting for him now in Marseilles. Would Paul join him for a trip, he asked, and Paul hesitated for a moment. If no news came by Friday, this was a Monday, then he should go to London and deliberately find out his lady's name and kingdom. In that case, to cruise in those waters might suit his book passing well. So he asked for a few days' grace, and Captain Grigsby gave a friendly growl in reply, and thus it was settled. By Saturday he was to give his answer. Tuesday passed, and Wednesday, and on Thursday a telegram came for Paul which drove him mad with joy. It was short and to the point. Meet Dmitri in Paris. Then followed an address. By rushing things he could just catch the night boat. He went to his father's room, where Sir Charles was discussing affairs with his land steward. The man retired. "Father," said Paul, "I'm going immediately to Paris. I have not even time to wait and see my mother. She is out driving, I hear. Will you understand, Father, and make it all right with her?" And Sir Charles said, as he wrung his son's hand, "Take care of yourself, Paul. I understand, my boy. And remember, Grig and I are with you to the bone. Wire if you want us, and let me have your news." So they had parted without fuss, deep feeling in their hearts. Paul had telegraphed to the address given for Dmitri that he would be in Paris and what hotel by the following morning. He chose a large caravanserai as being more suitable to unremarked comings and goings, should Dmitri's visit be anything of a secret one, and with intense impatience he awaited the faithful servant's visit. He was eating his early breakfast in his sitting-room when the old man appeared. In all the journey Paul had not allowed himself any speculation. He would see and know soon. That was enough. But he felt inclined to grind the silver-haired retainer's hand with joy as he made his respectful obeisance.
"The Excellency was well?"
"Yes. And now for his news." Madame had bid him come and see the Excellency here in Paris, as not being so inaccessible as England, and first, "Yes, Madame was well," there was something in his voice as he said this which made Paul exclaim and question him closely, but he would not only repeat that, "Yes, his lady was well, a little delicate still, but well." And the never sufficiently to be beloved son was well, too, his lady had told him, to assure the Excellency, and was the portrait of his most illustrious father. And the old man lowered his eyes while Paul looked out of the window and thrilled all over. Circumstances made things very difficult for Madame to leave the southern country where she was at present, but she had a very strong desire to see the Excellency again, if such meeting could be managed. He paused, and Paul exclaimed that of course it could be managed, and he could start that night. But Dmitri shook his head. That would be impossible, he said. Much planning would be needed first. A yacht must be taken, and not until the end of May would it be safe for the Excellency to journey south. At that time, Madame would be in a chateau on the seacoast, and if the Excellency and his crews could be within sight, he might possibly land at a suitable moment and see her for a few hours. Paul thought of Captain Grigsby.
"I will come in a yacht whenever I may," he said to Dmitri.
So they began to settle details. Paul imagined from Dmitri continuing to call his queen plain Madame that she still wished to preserve her incognito, so madly as he desired to know, he would wait until he saw her face to face, and then ask to be released from his promise. The time had come when he could bear the mystery no longer, but he would not question Dmitri. All his force was turned to extracting every detail of his darling's health and well-being from the old servant, and in his guarded, respectful manner he answered all he could. His lady had indeed been very ill, Paul gathered, at death's door. Ah, this was terrible to hear, but lately she was mending rapidly. Only she had been too ill to plan or make any arrangements to see him. How all this made his heart ache. Something had told him his passionate anxiety had not been without cause. Dmitri continued, Madame's life was not a happy one, the Excellency must know, and the difficulties surrounding her had become formidable once or twice. However, the brother of Madame was with her now, and had been made guardian of her son, so things were peaceful and the cause of all her trouble would not dare to menace further. For once Dmitri had let himself go as he spoke, and a passionate hate appeared in his quiet eyes. The trouble was of so impossible a viciousness that only the nobility and goodness of Madame had prevented his assassination numbers of times. He was hated, he said, hated and loathed. His life, spent in continual drunkenness and worse, unspeakable wickedness, was not worth a day's purchase but for her. The son of Madame would be loved forever for her sake, so the Excellency need not fear for that, and Madame's brother was there and would see all was well. Then Paul asked Dmitri if his lady had been aware that he had been ill in Venice, and he heard that, yes, indeed, she had kept herself informed of all his movements, and had even sent Vasily back on learning of his danger, and was on the point of throwing all prudence to the winds and returning herself. Oh, Madame had greatly suffered in the past year, the old man said, but she was more beautiful than ever, and of the gentleness of an angel, taking continuous pleasure in her little son. Indeed, Anna had said this was her only joy, to caress the illustrious infant and call him Paul. Such name he had been christened, after a great uncle. And again Dmitri lowered his eyes, and again Paul looked out of the window and thrilled. Paul! She had called him Paul, their son. It touched him to the heart. Oh, the mad longing to see her! Must he wait a whole month? Yes, Dmitri said, there was no use his coming before the 28th of May, for reasons which he could not explain connected with the to-be-hated troublesome one. Every detail was then arranged, and Dmitri was to send Paul maps and a chart, and the exact description and name of the place where the yacht was to lie. The whole thing would take some time, even if they were to depart tomorrow. "The yacht is at Masai now," Paul said, "and we shall start on the cruise next week. Let me have every last instruction post restant at Constantinople, and for God's sake send me news to Naples on the way." Dmitri promised everything, and then, as he made his obeisance to go, he slipped a letter into Paul's hand. Madame had bidden him give the Excellency this when they had talked, and all was settled. He would leave again that night, and his present address would find him till 6 o'clock if the Excellency had aught to send in return. And then he backed out with deep bows, and Paul stood there clasping his letter, a sudden spring of wild joy in his heart. And what a letter it was! The very soul of his loved one expressed in her own quaint words. First she told him that now she expected he knew who she was, and as they were to meet again, which in the beginning she feared might never be, all reason for her incognito was over. Then she told him, to make sure he knew, her name and kingdom. But, sweetheart, she added, remember this. My proudest titles ever are to be thy loved one and the mother of thy son. Here Paul kissed the words, madly thrilling with pride and worship. She spoke of her still undying love and of her anguishing sorrow all the winter at their separation, and at length the joy of their little one's arrival. Thy image, my Paul, English and beautiful, as I said he would be, not black and white like me. And, O beloved, thou must always increase thy knowledge of statesmancraft to help me to train him well. Then she made a glorious picture of their child's future, and Paul lay back in his chair and closed his eyes. The brightness of it all dazzled him, while his heart flew to her in passionate adoration. She went on to speak of their possible meeting. Her villa was but 200 yards from the sea, only he must follow exactly all Dmitri's instructions, or there might be danger for them both. But at all costs, she could not live much longer without seeing her lover. Thou art more than a lover now, my Paul, and I am more than ever thine. Thus it ended, and Paul spent most of the rest of his day reading and rereading it, and writing his worshipping answer. By night, both he and Dmitri had started on their homeward journeys. End of chapter 27. Chapter 28 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Amy Deutschler. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 28. The Lady Henrietta was desolated when Paul and his father announced their intention of taking a month or 6 weeks' cruise with Captain Grigsby. So unnecessary, she said, at this time of the year, almost the beginning of May, when England was really getting most enjoyable, and they were obliged to pacify her as best they could. The Mediterranean, such miles off, and so eccentric, too, starting when other people would be leaving. Really, she had never ceased regretting ever having tolerated her son's travels the year before. Since then, there had been no certainty in any of his movements. "Darling mother," said Paul, "I must see the world." And Sir Charles had snorted and chuckled, as was his habit. So they sailed away from Marseille, this party of three, like a gunboat under sealed orders. A cruise to the Greek Isles and beyond was what they said attracted them.
"Especially the beyond,"
Captain Grigsby had added, with a grunt to Sir Charles. And if the ardor of love and impatience boiled in Paul's veins, the spirit of interested adventure animated his old friend and his parent. They had not spoken much on the subject to the young man. He had briefly asked Mark Grigsby to do him this service, to take him to a far sea in the new blue heather, and there to land him when he should give the word. May was a fair month, and an adventure is an adventure all the world over. So Mark Grigsby had given a joyful assent. Then Sir Charles had suggested accompanying them, and was welcomed by the other two as a third for their party with extra pleasure.
"I shall grow a young man before I have done, Grig,"
he had said happily. But down in his heart lurked some undefined fear for Paul, and that was the real reason for his journey. They had a pleasant voyage, and picked up letters at Naples, which only added to Paul's impatience to be there. But they were not to arrive before the end of May, so the Grecian archipelago could be investigated. Life in these sunny seas was a joy to all concerned, and Paul's eyes, illuminated by his lady's ever-present spirit, saw beauties and felt shades and balances of which his companions never dreamed. So they came at last to the Bosphorus and Constantinople. Here full instructions awaited them. That night Paul took his father and his friend some way into his confidence, as he showed them the chart and read aloud the directions. On the 29th of May, should the weather prove favorable, they were to anchor towards night at a certain spot, latitude and longitude given, and when they heard a seabird cry sharply three times, Paul was to come ashore to where he would see a green light. Vasily would be waiting for him, and from there it was but a few steps to the garden gate of the villa by the sea, in which his lady was passing the summer. It all seemed perfectly simple, only, the directions added, he must leave again before dawn, and the yacht be out of sight before daylight, as complications had occurred since the letter to Naples, and the to-be-hated one had not left the capital, so things were not so easy to manage or safe. Paul's impatience knew no bounds. The concentrated, pent-up longing of all these months was animating him. To see his lady again, to clasp her, to kiss her, to kneel to her, and give her homage and worship, and to behold his little son. Always he carried the minute flaxen curl in a locket, and often he had looked at it, and tried to picture the wee head from which it had been cut. But she, his love, would bring his son to him, and perhaps let him hold him in his arms. Ah, he shut his eyes and imagined the tender scene. Would she be changed? Should he see the traces of suffering? But he would caress all memory of pain away, and surely this meeting would only be the forerunner of others to come. Fate could never intend such deep, true love as theirs to be apart. An exultation uplifted him, and if his lady were a queen and wore a crown, he felt himself the greatest king on earth. For was not he the absolute ruler of her heart? And who could wish for a more glorious kingdom? The hours from Constantinople seemed longer than the whole voyage. He could hardly keep his attention to talk coherently about ordinary things at meals, and his father and Mark Grigsby left him practically alone. At last, the 29th of May dawned, boiling hot and cloudlessly fair. For obvious reasons they stayed beyond sight of the coast until darkness fell, and then came close inshore. It was a starlit night, with not a breath of air, and no moon would illuminate their whereabouts. Paul dressed with the greatest care. Never had he been more particular over his toilet. Thompson found him exigent. He had broadened and filled out in the past year, and his fair face was tanned and blooming with health and excitement.
"The best-looking young devil a woman's eye could light on," Mark Grigsby said,
as he and Sir Charles watched him descend the gangway to the boat, when the impatiently awaited signal had been given.
"God keep him safe, Grig,"
was all Sir Charles could mutter, with a grunt in his throat. The maddest excitement was racing through Paul as he held the tiller ropes and made straight for the light, and once he felt in his pocket to assure himself he had not forgotten Dmitri's pistol, which he had cleaned and loaded himself that afternoon. He knew this adventure might be a dangerous one, simple as it looked superficially, and now he was an expert revolver shot, thanks to constant practice. The light proved to be in a little sheltered cove with a small landing stage. And yes, the man who held it was the Kalmuk, Vasily. "Welcome, welcome to the Syatsevo," he whispered, as he kissed Paul's hand. And then, in perfect silence, they began to ascend a path. Presently it stopped abruptly. They had come up perhaps not 50 feet, when their way was barred by a great nail-studded door. "Hist!" said Vasily softly, and instantly it was opened from within, and Dmitri peered anxiously at them. "Ah, the saints be blessed! The Excellency is safe," he said. But they must not delay a minute, he added. The Excellency must return to the waiting boat. A slight but unexpected ill fortune had befallen them, connected with the to-be-execrated troublesome one, and it would not be safe for the Imperial Highness if the Excellency should land tonight. She had sent him to say that the Excellency was to keep out at sea for 2 days and return steaming past, and if he saw a white flag flying from the villa roof, then at night he was to anchor and come ashore at this same time. If not, for the moment he must go on back to Constantinople, where news and further instructions would be sent him. As he spoke, Dmitri indicated the return path and bid the Excellency follow him and hasten, hasten. This was a terrible blow to Paul, but the thought that he might bring danger to his beloved one made him not hesitate a moment. They descended the path in silence. As he stepped into the boat, the old servant whispered, "The Imperial Highness had bidden him assure the Excellency that all was well. The meeting was only deferred when they should have several days together in safety." "The saints protect the Excellency," the faithful creature added. Then, when Paul was safely in the boat, he stood back to make sharply 3 times the seabird's cry. The weird minor notes floating out in the night seemed a wailing echo of the agonized disappointment in Paul's heart. More than once, a mad impulse to go back convulsed his being before he reached the yacht, but it was not till afterwards that he remembered as a strange circumstance the fact that with Dmitri's first words at the nail-studded door, Vasily had vanished into darkness. End of chapter 28. Chapter 29 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Amy Deutschler. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 29. The 2 days out at sea were a raging impatience to Paul, in which he learnt to understand all the torments of Tantalus, to know and feel her near, and yet not be allowed to get to her. It was an impossible cruelty. The 2 gray-headed men's hearts ached for him, and Captain Grigsby delivered himself of this aphorism.
"Say what you will, Charles, but youth pays the devil of a long price for its pleasures. Here you and I snored like a couple of porpoises all last night, while the boy paced the deck and cursed everything."
And Sir Charles had only grunted, for he was feeling very deeply for his son. There was a fresh breeze blowing when the time was up and they sighted land again, and long before any possible shore could be examined, Paul stood, his strongest glasses in his hand, on the lookout. At length they came in full view, and alas, there could be no mistake, the flagstaff upon the villa roof was empty. To the day of his death Paul will keep a vivid picture of the pure white columned house. No semi-oriental architecture met his view, but a beautiful marble structure in the graceful Ionic style, seemingly a suitable habitation for his queen. It was approached by groves of ilex, from a wall at the edge of the sea, and now Paul could discern the landing stage and the great studded door. A sensation of foreboding, a wild, mad anxiety filled his being. What had happened? Why might he not land? Then for the first time that fact of Vasily's vanishment came into his mind. Was there something sinister in it? Had he scented any danger to his queen and gone to sea? A whirlwind of questions and frenzied speculation shook Paul's brain. But there was nothing to be done now but to cram on all steam and make for Constantinople. He looked again. The green jalousies were lowered over the windows. All seemed peaceful, silent, and deserted. No living being wandered in the gardens. It might have been a mausoleum for the dead. And as this thought came to him, Paul almost cried aloud. Then he dominated himself. How weak and intolerably foolish to imagine evil where perhaps none was! Why should his thoughts fly to terrible reasons for the postponement of his joy, when in truth they could as well be of the simplest? A sudden call to the city, a descent of some undesirable spying eye, 101 possible things all much more likely than anyone's of fear. He would not permit another moment of wonder. He would regain his calm and wait like a man for certainty. Thus his face wore an iron mask, and his thoughts an iron band. And presently they came to Constantinople. But of what followed afterwards it is difficult to write, for fate struck Paul on that warm June morning and blasted his life, so that for many days he only saw red and lived in hell. Everyone knows the story which at the time convulsed Europe. How a certain evil-living king, after a wild orgy of mad drunkenness, rode out with two boon companions to the villa of his queen, and there, forcing an entrance, ran a dagger through her heart before her faithful servants could protect her. And most people were glad, too, that this brute paid the penalty of his crime by his own death, his worthless life choked out of him by the queen's devoted Kalmuk groom. But only Paul and his father and Mark Grigsby know the details, which were told in Dmitri's heartbroken letter, how that night, the 29th of May, at the hour the Excellency was expected, he, Dmitri, was waiting in the garden to meet him and conduct him through the gloom, when, while he stood there under the stars, the Imperial Highness had called him softly, telling him to take the message down to the Excellency, which he did. How he had never dreamed that immediate danger threatened her, or that the king was there, or he would not have left her for any peril to the Excellency, who was after all a man and could fight. And how Vasily, being younger and more quick of wit, had suspected, hearing his message as he gave it to the Excellency, that all was not well, and had hastened to the house, too late to save his queen. And then the faithful servant took up Anna's tale, how this good girl had been watching on the side of the villa towards the town and had heard the king come battering at the gate, how she had flown to warn her mistress, but that the Imperatorsky had sent her back to watch, saying she herself would call Dmitri to protect them. Of course, as they now guessed, on purpose that Anna should not hear her message to him, as the queen knew full well if he, Dmitri, heard from Anna the king was there, and she, the queen, in danger, he would not leave her even to do her bidding. Then of how the king had thrust the frightened servants aside and strode with threats and oaths into the hall, accompanied by his two vile men. And how Anna had implored the queen to hide while there was yet time. But how that shining one had stood only listening intently for the sea-bird's cry, and then when she heard it, had turned in triumph to the entering king, saying to Anna that nothing mattered now the Excellency was safe. On her face, as she looked at this monster, was no dread of death, or aught but scorn and fearless pride. How Anna, seeing the dagger, had screamed and tried to get between, but had been seized by one of the execrated men, and there been forced to watch the murder of her worshipped queen. Ah, that had been a moment the saints could never efface. The splendid lady had stood quite still, her head thrown back, while this hound of hell had lurched towards her, hissing through his evil teeth this dreadful sentence.
Since thou hast last obeyed me and found me an heir, making the people love me, I have no more use for thee. It will be a joy to kill thee.
And with that, he had plunged the dagger in her heart. Of all that followed, the Excellency would know. How Vasily had entered, scattering the minions like a mad bull, and springing upon the villainous king, had torn his life out on the marble floor. Thus ended the letter. Ah, God! For Paul had come the tears, but for her, cold steel and blood. And so, as ever, the woman paid the price. End of chapter 29. Chapter 30 of 3 Weeks. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Amy Deutschler. 3 Weeks by Elinor Glyn. Chapter 30. Now some of you who read will think her death was just because she was not a moral woman. But others will hold with Paul she was the noblest lady who ever wore a crown. And in all cases she is beyond our puny reasonings. But her work in Paul's heart still lives, and will live to the end of his life. Although for long months after the agony of that June day, nothing but hate and passion and misery had the ruling of him. He could not bear his kind. His father and Captain Grigsby had left the yacht to him and let him cruise alone. But who can know of the hideous, ghastly hours that Paul spent then, ever obsessed with this one bitter thought? Why had he not gone back? Why had he not gone back when that impulse had seized him? Why had Vasily and not he had the satisfaction of killing this vile slayer of his queen? Even the remembrance of his child did not rouse him. It was safe with the Grand Duke Peter, a king at 4 months old. But what of sons or kings or countries? Nothing could make up for the loss of his queen. And to think that she had died to save him. Save him from what? A brush with 3 besotted drunkards, whom it would have been great joy to kill. There were moments when Paul went mad with passion, and lay and writhed in his berth. So long months passed, and at last he dominated himself enough to come back to his home. And if the Lady Henrietta had exclaimed that he appeared ill before on his return, she was dumb now with sorrow at the change. For Paul had looked upon Medusa's head of horror, and, as well as his heart, his face seemed turned to stone. He was gentle with his mother, and let her caress him as much as she would, but nothing anyone could say could move him, even Pike's joyous greeting. The whole of God's world was his enemy, for was he not alone there, robbed of his mate? Presently the reaction from this violence came, as an intense apathy set in. A saltless, tasteless existence. What was Parliament to him? What was his country or his nation, or even his home? Only the hunting when it came gave him some relief, and then if the run were fast enough, or the jumps prodigiously high, or his horses sufficiently fresh to be difficult, his blood ran again for brief space. But beyond this life was hell, and often he was tempted to use that little pistol of Dmitri's and end it and sleep. Only the inherent manly English spirit in him, deep down somewhere, prevented him. All this time his father grieved and grieved, and the Lady Henrietta spent hours in tears and prayer. Sir Charles had told her their son had met with a great sorrow, and they must bow their heads and leave him in peace, so there were no more gay young parties at Verdane Place, and gone forever were the visions of the grandchildren. Only Mark Grigsby was a constant visitor, but then he knew. Thus a year passed away, and Paul left on a voyage round the world. An Englishman's stern duty to be a man at all costs was calling him at last, bidding him in charge of scene to try and overcome the paralyzing dominion of his grief. But as far as that went, the experiment proved futile. If moments came when circumstances did divert him, such as one or two great storms he happened to come across, and one or two exciting situations, still, when things were fair and peaceful, back would rush the ever-living ache, that passionate void and loss for which there seems no remedy. Gentle, pleasant women longed to lavish worship upon him, and Paul talked and was polite, but all their sweetness touched him no more than summer ripples stir the bottom of a lake. He seemed impervious to any human influence, though when the look of a mountain or the color of beech trees would remind him of the Bergenstock, anguish as fresh as ever stabbed his heart. Yet all this while, unknown to himself, his faculties were developing. He read deeply. He had unconsciously grown to apply his darling's lucid reasoning to every detail of his judgment of life. It was as if it had before been written in cipher for him, and she had now given him the key. His mind was untiring in its efforts to master subjects, as his splendid physique seemed tireless in all manner of sport. Thus he saw the world and its peoples, and was an honored guest among the great ones of the earth. But the hardness of adamant was in him. He had no beliefs, no ambitions. He dissected everything with all the pitiless certainty of a surgeon's cold knife. And if his life contained an aim at all, it was to get through with it and find oblivion in eternal sleep. Thoughts of his little son would sometimes come to him, but when they did, he thrust them back and shut his heart up in a casing of ice. To feel was to suffer. That, perhaps, was his only creed, that and a blind, sullen rage against fate. This was the lesson his suffering had taught him, and they were weary years before he knew another side. The first time he saw a tiger in India was one of the landmarks in the history of his inner emotions. He had gone to shoot the beasts with a well-known rajah, and it had chanced he came upon a magnificent creature at very close quarters, and had shot it on sight. But when it lay dead, its wonderful body gracefully moving no more, a sickening regret came over Paul. Of all things in creation, none reminded him so forcibly of his lost, worshipped queen. In a flash came back to him the first day she had lain on the skin which had been his gift. Out of the jungle her eyes seemed to gleam. In his ears rang her words, "I know all your feelings and your passions, and now I have your skin for the joy of my skin." Yes, she had loved tigers and been in sympathy with them always, and here was one whose joy of life he had ended. No, he could never kill one more. After this expedition for weeks he was restless. The incident seemed to have pierced through his carefully cultivated calm. For days and days, fresh as in the first hours of his grief, came an infinite sensation of pain, just hideous personal pain. So time and his journeys went on, but no country and no change of scene could dull Paul's sense of loss and the great, vast, terrible finality of all hope. The hackneyed phrase would continually ring in his brain of, "Never again, never again!" Ah, God, it was true he would hold his beloved one, "Never again!" And often unveiling rebellion against destiny would rise up in him, and he would almost go mad and see red once more. Then he would rush away from civilization out into the wild. But these violent emotions were always followed by a heavy, numb lethargy until some echo or resemblance roused him to suffering again. The scent of tuberoses caused him anguish unspeakable. One night in New York, he was obliged to leave the opera because a woman he was with wore some in her dress. Thus, with all his strong will, there were times when he could not control himself or his grief. He had been absent from England for over 2 years when the news came to him far out in America of his Uncle Hubert's death. So he had gone to join the world of spirits in the vast beyond. Paul did not care. His only feeling was one of relief. No more fear of hearing, perhaps, some chance idle word. But he remembered his mother had loved her handsome brother, and he wrote a tender letter home. Then something in Lady Henrietta's answer touched him vaguely and decided him to return. After all, because life was a black, barren waste to him, what right had he to dim all joy in the two who had given him being? Yes, he would go back and try to pick up the threads anew. There were great, quiet rejoicings in his parents' hearts at their son's third homecoming. And like a wild beast tamed for a time to perform tricks in a circus, Paul conformed to the ordinary routine. The question of his entering Parliament was mooted again, but this he put aside. As yet he could face no ties. He would do his best by staying at home most of the year, but when that call of anguish was upon him, he must be free once more to roam. Then hope began to bloom in the Lady Henrietta's heart as flowers after rain. Surely this great unknown grief was passing. Surely her adored one would settle down again. End of chapter 30.